Hi everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com and this will be part two of our mid-July garden tour. We like to start off here at the end of the driveway where we have sedum that is about to blossom, which is wonderful, and bleeding heart, which are done and could be taken down at this point. But we have these. These are morning glories. These morning glories I planted almost 10 years ago.
Yeah, but they were so pretty.
They were very, very pretty. But even though I tried to get as many flowers off of them as possible, pull them out before they went to seed, some of them went to seed anyway. And the seeds, every year, keep rejuvenating themselves.
And so they strangle everything around here too, including, they can get so invasive, they'll climb the apple tree.
Yes. I mean, they'll climb
like
over
bindweed.
The bushes, they'll climb over the hosta. As you can see, they're related to bindweed. So I'm always hesitant on morning glories. At some point, I will be pulling out all of this morning glory again. And if that doesn't work, then we'll probably have to redo the side of the driveway because I don't know if that would even stop it. But it's a little thing. I'm not going to worry about it. Another thing I wonder about why we ever added it is this chameleon plant. Now, I think it was because it was so pretty. It had the red stems, the green leaves with the yellow. It has
little white blossoms.
It looks so cute. And I remember I got it from a friend of mine, and I didn't realize that it was going to spread the way it has spread.
It has spread in so many different parts of our garden area. Even digging it out doesn't help.
No, digging out doesn't help. Roundup doesn't help.
And we rarely use Roundup. I mean, that's like our last...
last resort.
Last option.
But you can see that it is...
Nice and healthy in here.
Getting prolific in here, as is this tree. But it's an interesting... This is mostly shady during the day. So, not only shade... Well, it gets sun in the morning and shade the rest of the day. As I look at this part of the garden and look down this way, it looks very lovely and I'm happy with how it looks. But as any gardener will tell you, just like an artist, you see the flaws. Same with gardening, you see the weeds. But as a whole, it looks very nice.
Well, I think it's really has changed in probably the last 4 years specifically. Well, when we removed all of that, our wood berm fence that we had all around with little 18-inch logs from when we had to cut down trees. And then, of course, the city wanted to fine us $5,000 a day if we didn't remove it.
Right.
So then we put up a fence and we had such a bare area here. To me, it was always kind of embarrassing because, you know, you just get something done and it looks so pretty and then you have to totally rethink everything.
Right.
But that was a blessing in disguise.
As it turns out, we have the pink you see is rose mallow and the orange you see is tickweed. And this will be butterfly weed, milkweed. It's a milkweed family. Seed themselves, as you can see at the bottom, there are going to be more coming after this. The grasses, the different grasses we put in. The orange here is tickweed that I was going to get rid of, but Rick really liked it, so we didn't get rid of it. The orange in the back there, the darker orange, is butterfly weed. That's a type of milkweed. The butterflies do like it. Even the monarchs will come to it and get the nectar out of it. I like it because it stays upright. It doesn't flop over. It will reseed itself, and it's a very bright orange. I like that. These are Rick's favorite Chinese lanterns that I swear at some point will join us in the house somewhere.
These are almost, 3 foot tall already?
Uh-huh.
I mean, they've grown very well in this area.
They like this area. And then here's that chameleon weed again.
Yeah.
Trying to, as is over here. And there's your creeping buttercup.
Yeah.
That somehow got over here. This is our quince that is finally now, I think, done blossoming, but the bee balm is now blossoming in the back.
And peaches galore.
Butterflies love bee balm. Yep, and lots of peaches. That's good. Tiger lilies.
How is Lecter and Peter Pan? Ah, look what's here again.
Oh, no. One time I planted sweet peas. This is as bad as the morning glories. How they got way over here is beyond me, but I keep pulling them out. They are very invasive, and again, they like to climb all over everything. I know this will never stop them, but at least it makes me happy having.
Yeah, I've seen you go around and constantly pull these out.
Fleece plant. But then you also have to be on guard, because there I see garlic mustard. Right there.
Yep.
Not
the
good.
Nemesis.
Yep, not good.
And some more.
And these are done. I think these were, again, the rose mallow, I think. Yes, they are. But they're done for whatever reason. Bindweed, I can see bindweed in there.
Oh, good.
There's your millet.
Oh, yeah. And it's starting to blossom, too.
It's very happy there.
Very happy.
Mm-hmm.
That plant always impressed me.
And then if you want a weed, see the green with the little yellow is wood sorrel, and that will go everywhere.
Yep, I can't tell you how many times I pull that out, and look what's starting to blossom.
Liatris.
Your favorite plant, one of your favorites, liatris.
Yep.
Some more tick.
These are columbines here. They're done, you can hear the seeds rattling. So these could be broken off and just sprinkled around wherever you want.
And your butterfly garden is really starting to take off nicely.
Very nicely. And not a whole lot blossoming at this point. We have Sweet Williams, some Black-Eyed Susans, some Lantana. Don't look at those trees. Some more butterfly weed back there.
Yep.
Some of the blue there. I'm not quite sure what that is, but I'm sure that's part of it. That's some kind of mallow. It's not rose mallow. It's some other kind of mallow.
Hmm.
And then my liatris is doing nicely there. Now, this is another area where we have milkweed. Now, this milkweed planted itself again. I've taken quite a bit out. That's liatris.
Yeah, look at the pouch. Look at the yellow pouches of pollen on that.
On that bee.
Yeah, that's amazing.
That bee. Well, it's full of pollen.
Yeah. Wow.
Yep. Very good.
And you're how about
good
your.
Job. This is my fine line buckthorn.
Yeah.
Yes, a good buckthorn. But you see.
So soft.
No seeds in there that will blossom anywhere. Here, I always like to look at the backs of these milkweeds to see if there are any caterpillars, especially if you see chewed on pieces, but nothing yet.
Yeah. And this common milkweed has been here for years and years. I mean, look at the height of this. Stand next to it once.
As tall as I am.
That's almost 6 foot tall.
Smells great.
I love the blossoms. I mean, those are, like you mentioned in part one, they are so fragrant.
They look like fireworks.
Yeah. And look at that fleece plant behind. That's got to be at least 8 foot tall already.
That fleece plant is really happy.
Yeah.
Really, really happy. I don't think I'm ever going to see the flowers that I planted in there.
Yep, a few flowers have made it, but not very many.
Mm-hmm.
So even over in this little patch, looks like there are more weeds over there than there are flowers this year. But
right.
Now, I mean,
and sometimes your milkweed will get, at least ours does, it gets aphids on it.
Yeah.
And then the ants come along and take care of that. So.
But I did see a lot of ladybugs on here last time.
There's some right here. Yeah. They love aphids. Yeah, so there's another one.
Yeah.
And then are those ladybug babies? Yes, those are ladybug babies.
Mm.
They look like little scrub brushes.
Yeah.
But we have some flowers coming up in there.
Oh, I see your canna is coming up back there.
Yes.
At least we'll have something in there this year.
Mm-hmm. More peaches?
Yeah. And look what else is over here.
Yes, there it is again.
That is amazing to try to eradicate and get rid of once you put it in.
Mm-hmm.
There's some over there, more.
Yep, another fleece plant. Now these are getting to the point where I will be cutting these back soon because I don't like it when they sprawl out all over everywhere. But for right now, with the white blossom going, it's too pretty to cut back. This is a forsythia bush that last summer was eaten so badly by the rabbits during the winter we hardly had any yellow blossoms on. This year it did very well. And we are about to trim this one because now's the time to be trimming those spring blooming bushes because you don't want to do it later or you'll have no blossoms next year.
Look at all those mushrooms. Those are cool.
Those are neat mushrooms.
Yeah.
Now those were all hiding behind that bleeding heart to your left.
Okay. Which you've chopped off already.
I have.
Now look what else. Now that's the holly plant we had.
That's holly, right.
It's hanging in there.
Yep, it gets hidden by the bleeding heart. And then we thought we had all of this dug out. This is a trumpet vine again. It came back.
Well, it was so huge. It was actually a thicket inside of this thing last year.
Yeah. It was just taking over. So
I mean, it has beautiful flowers, which is what we'd like to begin with, but this is not the spot for it.
No, it isn't. And this is phlox, the good phlox, along with I see a black walnut tree. But as I pointed out to Rick the other day, it's already beginning to get powdery mildew because it's been so
hot and humid and wet.
Right. Now here's a plant that I would love if somebody could identify this for me. This purple one, and we have some along the driveway that I was. Here's the look at this. That's the mildew already.
Mildew.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now they're known for that. But see this.
Isn't there some kind of a bell? I'm trying to think of.
Well, you'd think so, and you'd think it would be nice because it's so pretty, and the leaves are kind of heart shaped. But this was the kind I think that has such an invasive root structure that when we had it the first time and I thought it was lovely, and then my friend came over and said, you don't want that in your garden because it's going to take over. Every now and again it pops up someplace, and this year it's popped up here and over along the driveway.
Yeah, it's under your birch tree.
Under my birch. So I think that's going to be gone. If somebody knows what that is, I'd appreciate knowing. These are the hostas that always get slug holes in them. The slugs like this part of the garden, I guess.
Well, we actually let them feast over here so they don't mess with all the other ones.
That's
of course,
right.
They don't like the other ones, so these must be the tender ones.
Maybe. Maybe that's it.
Now, you did have a solution one year that you did.
I could do an ammonia. Is it ammonia that I use?
I think so.
Yes.
Yeah.
Solution, but I'm too busy to do that.
Well, you have a video on hosta slugs, so yes. If anybody's interested, you can check that video out.
And we like to keep bird baths around. Not only do the birds appreciate them, but so do the pollinators.
How about your lilac tree? I should say lilac bush that we keep
a lilac
in a
mound
shape.
Yes.
I see Sky missed a few when he was trimming for me.
I don't think he did this one.
Oh, didn't he?
No, I think it at that point didn't seem like it had too many escapees, but this one never blossoms because we keep trimming on it and it
doesn't have the old stock.
We don't want it to blossom, I guess. Our moss garden yesterday, it was starting to look pretty brown because we hadn't had rain for maybe 2 days.
Yeah, a whopping 2 days.
And with one night's rain, this is what happens.
Perked it back up.
Yep.
Nicely.
the sedums from our neighbor across the street, the Stelladora she gave us, are about to finish now, and then they will disappear. The Virginia bluebells that were so prolific and so big in here, just like we predicted, once they're done, they just disappear. The whole plant is gone. The roots are still there, but the plant is
Looks
gone.
Looks like you have an oak tree growing back there.
Uh-huh. It is an oak tree.
Right next to the birch clump.
And you know how that got there.
Yep. Thank you, little squirrelies.
Mm-hmm. And this is our purple leaf smoke tree, which has been going to town as far as its
blossoms
yeah, go.
I think
but
we showed that in the mid-June.
Mm-hmm. But it has been attacked by sawfly slugs. Not to the point where it's going to hurt anything, but, I mean, some of the leaves are kind of ugly.
And you have another oak tree under there.
Yeah, that's a happy one.
Yeah.
Very happy.
Wow.
And then we get to our Bosnian pine, which somehow makes it in all the shade from the purple smoke tree.
Well, I think we have to do a little trimming on this smoke bush.
We do.
Bush.
Yeah. So. We thought it was going to be a tree and it turned into a bush.
Yeah.
This is mock orange, which also is going to need some trimming. And now that it's done blooming, this is time to do that. And then our hydrangea is doing very nicely.
Now, I'm not sure this is the place for this hydrangea. I think it's too shaded, and we may have to move it to the sunny perennial garden with the other one.
Maybe. That might be a
we'll
good
see.
Place for. And then this little one here, I don't think we know what this is, but it's dainty and it's kind of pretty, so I'm not going to pull that one out at this point.
And then you have monk's hood, which is getting to be at least 4 foot tall.
Yes. I don't know that I like this curliness on it, but
yeah.
We'll see. One in the back doesn't have that.
And your honeysuckle
is taking over that fence there.
Yeah, well, I know that this is an ideal place for a total vertical, but our goal was to help train the vines,
we
hopefully.
We wanted it to go along the fence.
Yeah.
But the fence kind of got hidden.
Yeah. And hopefully your irises that you planted last year all along the fence
yes.
line will bloom next spring
right.
as well.
Now that is a hibiscus back there.
Yep.
I don't remember what color it is, but this is a knockout rose, the famous knockout roses.
And more honeysuckle, different mm-hmm. variety, grasses.
Yep. I think that's more phlox there.
Yeah. How about your little roses
little
that
roses.
I got you for Mother's Day?
Yep.
I mean, we thought
Who knew that they would turn into perennials?
This is what, their third summer?
Yep.
And then look what's blooming way back there.
Oh, that's Ligularia.
Yeah.
And it's happy this year because we've had so much rain, it can just not wilt every day.
Yeah, normally that thing would be flopping over on the ground.
And then look at this. This almost looks like an astilbe, doesn't it? But it's different.
Yeah.
It doesn't have an astilbe flower to it. I'm not quite sure what that
is.
I have
to do some research on that one. Uh-huh. Yeah, the leaf structure is similar.
You know, is that, I wonder, a different version of Queen on the Prairie? Because look at those leaves. Maybe.
Huh.
Somebody might know. If you do, please let us know.
And our Japanese irises, you've
done.
Yep. Doing those, and again, another huge fleece plant.
Right. That one I'll chop later. This is a re-blooming wigelia, and this is the second bloom now. I chopped some of them off. I think these are new ones coming. And there is another hibiscus. That one I think is going to be pink, if I remember correctly. I don't think you have a label for that one. And then there is a sumac that was supposed to be a non-aggressive sumac. It turns bright orangish red in the fall, and it was supposed to be just a very nice singular thing.
And look what's over there.
But then I'm looking over there and thinking, that looks like one of those. And then look over there.
Yeah.
There's another one.
Now, have we ever seen that go to seed? Or is
no,
that through a root?
I'm afraid it might be roots.
Well, we're going to have to keep a real close eye on that one.
Yep.
Or you're going to have a lot of sumac here.
This is another Japanese iris that I didn't chop down at this point. There weren't a whole lot that were pollinating and going to seed, so I just left it. And then another Ligularia, again, happy, because usually by this time of the year it's flopping over because it's too dry. These are Russian sage with bindweed, another nemesis. This is a Ligularia that does not rebloom, so that's one time.
Yeah, another Astilbe back there.
Yeah, that's a giant Astilbe.
Yeah, big.
And behind it is another Forsythia that was not chewed down like usual by the rabbits. This is a ground cover that Rick likes in here, but I don't. So I kind of keep that under control as much as possible. Another Astilbe. The hostas are now blooming. A lot of them are blooming. So it's cool to see all the different colors.
What is the red bush again?
That, I think, is a sandhill cherry bush.
Okay.
I don't know that
and
it ever gets
cherry. And here's our mystery
cherry.
Tree that we think mm-hmm. might be...
We were thinking it might be buckthorn, but I don't think so.
I haven't seen any thorns in there either.
Mm-mm. And then another mock orange, but it's right under this fern leaf Japanese maple that is just
that's pretty
wonderful.
Amazing. I mean, considering how delicate they are, and they don't really like to have their root system thawing and freezing, right. Thawing and freezing. So
must be very sheltered by the trees around it, and it does get sun in the winter.
Yeah, but this is now about 5 years old?
Mm-hmm.
So it's doing
really
quite well.
Yes. The ground cover here. There we have some red husker. And behind that, I believe, is another hibiscus.
We had a lot of alliums in there as well that you've already cut that
yes,
we're going to be decorating soon.
Yes, you see a couple of them.
Yep.
And you see that the hostas are blooming, which is always nice. Behind that, well, we have different grasses back there. That is a bridal wreath that is nicely trimmed now.
How about all your ferns?
And the ferns, this is a good year for ferns. They are doing wonderfully well.
They love this rain.
And this is what I keep handy all the time because it's just, I see weeds and I need some place to put them, so I dump them. That one right there is a new little perennial. That is a echinacea, but it's gonna be bright red.
You think it gets enough sun?
It is at the moment. I don't know.
We may have to relocate it to a different microclimate.
I may. Another Astilbe, more ferns.
And the white flowering, that was...
These we want to call snakeweed, I think.
Snakeweed, okay.
Yes, and that it's such a funny little thing because it has these little round balls on it and you think, oh, those are really cool. And then they blossom and then they get like furry looking. And this one I know has escaped because its big brother or sister is over there.
How about your witch hazel in the back
witch
there
hazel
that
is back
was
there.
Trimmed back
uh-huh.
recently? But there's another trumpet vine that's
yes.
getting crazy.
Yes, it is. Why it's growing in the shade of the maple tree is beyond me. This is a tamarack bush.
You know, I still want you to experiment with this. You know how you took the Montauk daisy?
And stuck it in the ground.
And stuck it in the ground?
It did.
It did?
Uh-huh.
Oh, so have you already experimented
I
with
did.
It?
I did.
Fantastic.
Not everyone, but at least a couple did.
Because I know you tried to water root them or get them to root in water, but water didn't work.
Water didn't work, but if you stick them right in the ground, then they do. And over on this side, before we get too far, these are balloon flowers. And these are the blue ones. They form a little, like a pale blue balloon. And then when it's time, they pop open and they'll have five petals, all connected in the middle.
And sometimes they're multicolored too, or have stripes or whatever.
They'll be blue and white, yes.
How about your tree peonies?
They are doing wonderfully. Obviously, they're done for the season as far as blossoming, but I did leave a couple of seed pods on them. This is the dark red one, and that's the pink one.
Yep.
But you can see the woody stock in here. So this is why they call them tree peonies, because they do not die down in the fall.
So they're not deciduous.
Right. No.
And then you've got more snakeweed that...
Yep. That was the original. Sometimes it gets really tall. But it's happy.
You do have a sunflower that made it here.
I know. Obviously the deer haven't found this one.
Yeah.
This was a bird seed. The bird did that.
Did we ever figure out what this was now that it's blossoming?
Queen of the Prairie.
That's Queen of the Prairie.
Yep.
Okay.
There were
delicate little blossoms.
Lots of
At first we were very concerned about the shape of that leaf.
You were.
Well, I thought one of our children were playing a little prank on us again. How about all the alliums that you took out of here?
Oh, they were, every stump you see there, every little stalk is an allium that I cut so that we can paint. And all the ones that you see here are liatris.
And
then here's another, this is a giant white hibiscus. It doesn't get as tall because it's in the shade.
You had a viewer this morning I saw who wanted to know whether their hibiscus was, I guess, a tropical version or a hardy one. And I think the reply was something to the effect, if I remember correctly, if it doesn't say hardy on it, it's probably a tropical version, which you're going to have to eliminate. You have something in your hair.
Nature.
I thought maybe you had a bee in your bonnet. But anyhow, if the tag doesn't say
hardy.
That it's hardy,
right.
Then in most cases it's probably a tropical version, which is something you're going to have to bring in fall before
Definitely.
The weather changes,
yep.
And wait till spring to put it back out again.
Yes.
So read the labels carefully.
Mm-hmm. Well, and then I think we went past
the rose
bush that came with this property. That we've moved
several times,
and more liatris. This is a really good year for liatris. I mean, it's getting really tall this year, so
that's got to be 4 foot tall already.
Thrills me, yes. Yeah. And more butterfly bush about to blossom.
Yep,
that's good. We still have one quince flower.
Now, this thing started blooming. I want to say at least 2 months ago.
Mid-May.
And I mean, it's still blossoming. Look at that. There's more blossoms over there and even
and
more buds here.
I have chopped on that a lot.
Maybe it's re-blooming.
Maybe. And then there's your Daphne.
Oh, yes.
It's already done blossoming.
Yep.
It's getting nice and full. So
can't tell you how long I looked for one after the one we had died. And no nursery carried it.
Finally you found it.
Yep.
And then here's our little pot thing that we got, I think at Aldi's, right?
Yep.
It's a three-tiered pot. Then the only thing you have to remember is every couple of days it needs to be turned so that the plants in the back get sun, because the sun comes from this way.
Well, you haven't had to do a lot of watering lately.
No, I haven't. And that's nice.
Yeah.
And then our...
Weeping
flowering cherry, we trimmed off it too. That was hanging down way too far. So.
Oh, you still have some vertical trimming that have to come off on that.
Yep. Oh, there's a nice bumble.
Oh, yeah.
He's a biggie. Oop, wherever he went, he was big.
He flew off quickly.
It's very big.
Now, I noticed yesterday you were doing a lot of trimming.
Well, this is one of the boxwoods, and sometimes boxwoods are affected by the sun and the wind in the winter. And I thought this one had been okay for this year. There was just one tiny little spot that didn't look good. It turned brown. And then as the season progressed, more and more of it became brown. So I thought, well, it's coming up from the bottom now by itself.
And that's a good indicator.
And I decided, well, I'll just take the good things and kind of make a little topiary out of it.
Yeah, I think it's cute. I like your little hanging bird bath in there.
That's been sitting on the ground for forever, and now I have a branch to hang it on.
And your primrose always so I mean, it's amazing. You go out in the middle of winter and it's still green.
Still green, right. It loves it. We didn't put a whole lot of time into doing baskets this year, but this is one from our daughter and son-in-law for Mother's Day. And it has not stopped blooming since Mother's Day. It just keeps up. Keeps on, keeps on. It's got a little bit of yellow to it. I hope the rain last night will boost it up again. Maybe it needs a little feeding. Then I'd like to thank Rick's student, Brian, who is one of Rick's very first students, who created this fun glass garden art, and then he hid it in the yard and we had to find it. And now we've put it up where we can enjoy it every day, every time we come out. It serves as a little watering place for all the pollinators too, which is nice.
I see your cosmos came back from seed.
Yes, those cosmos are tough.
That's 4 foot tall, easily.
Yep, they're very amazing. Happy. Yep, and then my liatris in the background there. See that? And then I wasn't going to do zinnias here this year, and then I couldn't help myself. And I did them anyway, and then Rick put wildflower mix around the outside.
That was the aromic mixture, if I remember correctly. I thought that would be kind of nice to have outside of our kitchen entrance. Mm-hmm.
And now it's kind of a waiting game to see what is weeds and what is flower. I know that is a weed right there because I've been pulling its friends out. Yeah. I'm not sure about all of those, like right around the edge there.
Yeah. We'll find out soon.
Look too happy.
How about your mallow?
Well.
Oh, that's not mallow.
Yeah, this is This is rose mallow.
Rose there.
It's okay. I think it's a zebra one. There were three here. And then yesterday when we came out, there was only one and the other two were chewed off.
Amazing.
Late night infomercials have brought us Chinese lilacs.
I couldn't resist.
Well, this is their second year now, and last year they just didn't do a whole lot. This year we've had many more flowers, but not as prolific as we were led to believe. I think after these guys get done, maybe I will trim them, even though they're supposed to be ever blooming.
Well, these are dwarf too.
Right, but look at how long this is. Yeah. You know, that's a little long. In between, I had planted liatris.
And you also have a...
And that's an azalea back
azalea
there.
Azalea behind the bird bath.
Yes, yeah. That's a happy azalea because in the spring, when it's getting ready to bloom, it gets plenty of sun. Now it's obviously more in the shade. Here's another bird food sunflower that the deer didn't find. This is a liatris that I transplanted from the walkway over there over here when we pulled out a questionable perennial that was getting all over everywhere, and when we took it to our class they identified it as something we didn't want, so it's gone. These nasturtiums and all of these little snapdragons seeded themselves,
including
and pop up. And then this is foxglove, which also has seeded itself.
Remember the one we had last year on our garden tour?
Right.
Oh my goodness,
yep.
That was huge.
The same place, but this isn't as large.
Well, that one had like a center stalk that had to be 5 foot tall.
And it had little side shoots.
And then it had this, I want to say 5 or 6 side shoots that were at least this size.
Yep.
I've not seen one like that.
Nope.
And then, of course, these snapdragons, which keep popping up.
And then there's this again. This is the same as we saw over there. Pretty.
Well, I have a feeling the word bell is associated with this plant.
I'm afraid. I know if I dug it up and if I saw its roots, I would, and it turned out to be that same plant.
And now you have the prairie coneflower that's back here, which will be blossoming shortly.
And I'm not sure that is what that is. We'll have to look at that one too. But I love the yellowish
chartreuse
hosta. And then
how about the mum that has survived here for at least 10 years?
That one and the one over there.
Yeah.
Yes. And then the coral bells are in there, and the blossoming hosta. Yeah. Very pretty. We thought we'd end part two outside of our kitchen window. Now, most of the day, this will get shade. In the morning and right about noon, which it is now, it'll get some sun. So in there are the two peony plants that I ordered and planted this spring. This one is a herbaceous one. This one's going to be bright red, and that is a hybrid that's half tree peony and half regular peony. So it'll be interesting to see.
And then your dwarf?
These are dwarf bleeding hearts. Okay. Mixed in with the coral bells.
And these coral bells look very healthy here.
Yes. Oh, and here's a very...
Look what's right there on top.
Oh.
Somebody was taking a bath.
Somebody bathed and left their feather here.
Oh, right, littering too.
And here's your butterfly weed.
Oh, yes.
There it is in all its glory.
I don't think I can have enough of these on the property.
And here's a maple tree.
Oh, you can pull that one.
And also another tree.
Huh.
All of this is those tiny little bluebells that was the ground cover in the spring that was just all over the place.
Yeah, well,
here's another tree too.
Over here.
Mm-hmm.
Still hanging in
there. So they're kind of ugly at this point, but they're pretty in the spring. More of your butterfly weed, more liatris, and then this is...
Is that that campanula?
It is a campanula, yep. Except I don't know that that leaf goes with what was blooming. We'll see. This is our Japanese maple that has grown so big. So pretty looking out my window to see it. Again, different kinds of coral bells.
Oh, look what's coming up.
Yep, and my elephant ears are finally starting to come up.
Oh.
I planted them a long time, weeks ago, and I thought, oh, maybe they're not going to come up this year.
Oh, you've got two more over here that are coming up, too.
Yep.
Yep.
That's how they start.
There's one, and there's one behind that hosta.
And then here's your prairie dock.
Oh, yeah, talk about the prairie dock.
Prairie dock, some of you may know, is a plant that has really deep roots. It's a prairie plant, obviously. It's a native plant. And if you went over and put your hands on each side of a leaf, even now in this hot sun, the leaves will feel cool. And we were told it's because they're getting their energy from so deep in the ground that transfers up and keeps them from burning out in the hot.
It's an interesting native plant.
Yes.
Almost like arrowhead-shaped leaves.
And they're very stiff. They're stiff leaves. But if I go like this, it feels cool.
Would the bigger leaf feel
it's
even
like,
cooler?
Yes. That one was cooler than this one. And this one's cooler than that one. It's amazing.
Yeah. Well, we still have some topiary work to do on these Alberta spruces.
Yep, every few years you have to reshape them. And we're thinking maybe we'll take the lower branches off because the birds don't go down there anyway.
Yeah.
But this will be the end of part two. Please stay tuned for part three of our mid-July garden tour. If you enjoyed this part, please give us a thumbs up. If you'd like to leave a comment, we'd love to hear from you. Thank you so much for watching, and if you want to become part of our garden family, please subscribe.
So what's in store for part three?
Well, part three is going to be after part lunch.
Oh, okay, because we'll be on the west side of the property,
yes.
Heading over to the original garden area,
yes.
What's happening in front of the pergola, and ending probably out by the free book library.
I think so.
Okay, well, let's go have lunch.
Okay.
Connect with us on YouTube.